So we are going to now talk about attitude control, okay. And the attitude control can be done using various means. You can have thrusters, you can have reaction wheels, momentum wheels. So you can have also other type of actuators people have come up with, but most important ones from application point of view so far have been thruster control. For example, the shuttle had all these attitude control thrusters. The space station has control moment gyros. So these are a bunch of rotating wheels, and if you change the direction of this rotating axis, you can get some torques. We'll do a little bit of mathematics later. So control moment gyros are very important applications, or reaction wheels, okay, also can be used, which are very similar in principle to control moment gyros. There are some small differences. The other type of actuators which are used very commonly for very small satellites are magnetotorquers, where you will have magnetic coils and there is current passing. So, when it crosses the magnetic field, you will have some torque generated. Okay. So, magnetotorquers are used for, let us say, we have all these nanosats or this CubeSats, magnetotorquers are typically used there. Okay. While for very large satellites, we will use either thrusters or control moment gyros. Okay. So, we will do a little bit of study using, if you are using these thrusters, or if you use, let us say, any means and you have some thrust and some control torques, how do we decide how much control torque, etcetera. So, we are going to look into this. So, here let us say we have a body here. So, if you are using thrusters like they had in the shuttle, then you will have see, for example, here you have these two rockets, okay, this thruster. So this can, so you can actually apply thrusts in these two. So you must have a moment arm. So this thrust should not be collinear. If there is collinear, if they are collinear, of course there will be no torque. So here you are applying two forces which are not collinear. So around the center of mass, they will give rise to a torque. But they are equal and opposite, so they are not going to affect your orbital motion. Okay. So, net force is 0, but net torque is not 0. Now, usually what you will have is that you will not have one pair. One pair, this pair is going to give rise to a torque about this z axis, okay, this moment. But you need control torques about x axis and y axis as well. So, you will have to have 3 pairs of thrusters. You may have even redundant pairs too, but at least 3 pairs of thrusters are necessary for 3 axis control. Now, the control systems for attitude control systems can be open loop or closed loop. Now, open loop control systems, actually they are not really accurate control systems. You can just give some command and they need human interaction. So, you have this attitude sensor data. So, you know attitude, and then you give a command to activate control, however, so fire the jets using certain sequence so that your attitude will change in a particular manner. But this is, there is no feedback in open loop control. So, you cannot actually have very good control when you are using open loop control systems. But in closed loop or feedback control system, you can have better control because if there is an error, you measure the error and then you try to bring this error close to 0. Okay. So, mostly you use closed loop or feedback control system, okay. But for that you will have to have an onboard computer to be able to calculate, because you cannot always expect from the ground station to give commands for closed loop system. So, you must have onboard computers. So, there they will receive attitude data from the sensors, and then based on this data they will command the thrusters to fire using some kind of control law. Okay. Now, quite often in space industry these control laws and laws have been very simple, although when we study our in our control courses we use a lot of very sophisticated control laws, you know, in addition to this PID law, you know, we study LQR, LQG, we study also Lyapunov control, robust control and all kinds of things. But most satellites that have flown so far use simple control laws, just you know PID control laws, for various reasons. PID control law is, you know, it is relatively easy to implement, simple laws, they work, and the space industry people are very conservative. Although we have much better knowledge about control, you know, we can use nonlinear control, but not many missions use nonlinear control. This is changing. We are now using, you know, other types of control also, not just a PID control, but many satellites which exist today, they use PID control. Now, all of you, I am sure you have taken control course, you know what is PID control. Okay. Now, when they use PID control, again many satellites in the past have used Euler angles to develop their control laws, but it is changing now. To do attitude calculation, at least determination, they are using Euler parameters now. Okay. But many spacecraft, they just follow the aircraft to express the attitude, they use pitch, roll and yaw angles. Now, even now you will see that many satellites they will talk about the pitch control loop and roll yaw control loop. So, this is actually quite standard. But again, as I said, it is changing. So, we will consider several things over here. We will start with, you know, simple pitch control, roll control, etcetera. Then we will go to, you know, 3-axis control, maybe a little bit nonlinear control tomorrow. But today we will start with the simplest approach. Let us say what is known as the pitch loop. Okay. Now, in this pitch loop, you have can I change that to z somehow? Okay. The pitch is about y axis, the 2-axis. So, you have y theta double dot plus 3 omega naught square, omega naught here is our n, orbital angular velocity, I x minus I z, this is I z, theta is your pitch angle, is equal to the disturbance torque plus the control torque. Okay. So, this is the pitch motion. Pitch motion is decoupled from roll yaw motion, as we saw, when we consider small disturbances, and you will have small disturbances if you have a controller, otherwise your controller is not working. Okay. So, usually these are small disturbances. So, it shows here, you know, you have, this is the pitch loop. So, this theta is your pitch angle. So, you measure this theta using, you know, you have a sensor, measure this theta, and then you give a theta reference. Now, normally this theta reference will be equal to 0, because you want the pitch angle to be 0. So, you have a theta reference only when you are going to reorient, then this theta reference will be non-zero. So, you measure this theta, so you will have this theta minus theta reference is the theta error, which will be basically theta if you want to maintain reference angle equal to 0. Then you will have some control logic, and then you may have disturbances. These disturbances will come from, as we saw in the graph, solar radiation torque or aerodynamic torque. But gravity gradient torque is not the disturbance that we put into satellite dynamics, because in the equation of motion we have, you know, here gravity gradient torque, actually this is basically gravity gradient torque. So, that is included, but this disturbance could be aerodynamic, solar radiation or aerodynamic torques or magnetic torques. Okay. So, then we put in, okay, that loop is missing. You also put in UI here, MY disturbances plus UI. So, this is MY disturbance plus U. You also have this control thrust over here. So, this is actually the external thrust which is coming from controller as well as from disturbance. So, the UI that you typically try to give, this is disturbance. You have no control over the disturbance. You only can say something about the control input from the thrusters or any other means, magnetotorquers, whatever. So, this UI typically, you know, you could have a proportional derivative gain. So, you will have UI equal to k d theta dot with a negative sign minus k p theta, and this is the derivative gain and this is the proportional gain. So, if you put this over here and then bring them to the right hand side, you will have I y theta double dot plus k d theta dot plus k p theta plus this gravity gradient. Let us call this as a constant A, because this is a constant A theta equal to m y disturbance. So, this is your controlled dynamics, and you have now this A, typically this A could be smaller, much smaller than k p, but not necessarily, but typically A would be smaller than k p. Okay, you put a proportional gain that overcomes this A. So, now what will be the dynamics of the control system depends on this k d and k p. K d, this one, this derivative gain gives rise to damping in the controller, so that you can bring it back to 0. Otherwise, if you do not have this k d theta dot, you will have just simple oscillation. You can make it stable, you can increase the frequency, but you cannot make it asymptotically stable unless you add this k d. So, you need to have a derivative gain. So, this determines then the damping of your pitch motion, and this will determine the frequency of control system. Okay. Now, the thing is, this may be good enough at certain times, but not necessarily always satisfying, because what happens is that you may have a steady state error. Okay. And the steady state error will be given by, you know, if you have this MY disturbance, let us say this is actually a constant solar radiation torque that you have. You know, we saw that solar radiation torque was a constant torque. Suppose this is a constant solar radiation torque. So, you will have a steady state error will be constant solar radiation torque divided by this k p plus a. That will be the steady state error. So, you have a steady state error unless you put an integral term. So, this integral term is to eliminate if you have some steady state error coming from this constant term over there. If you have an oscillatory torque, you may be able to, you know, you may be able to survive without this integral, but if you have here a constant term like the solar radiation torque, then you have to have an integral term. Okay. Now, this was actually just a single degree of freedom system, but if you have all three pitch roll and yaw motion, then of course, you have to consider the 3D attitude motion, the Euler's equation, where this is your control input and this is your disturbance torque. And again, you can use a linear feedback control law where u is proportional to two terms over there. Omega is the angular velocity, this angular velocity, which is actually proportional to the rates, angular rates, and then in the ke, e here is the error in the attitude. Okay, this is the attitude error, and then this attitude error, you know, this could be theta minus theta c. This is a vector. This is not one angle. This is a vector theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, three angles, minus the commanded attitude angle, which could be zeros if it is directionally maintained. Or if you are using quaternions, in that case this e will be an error quaternion, attitude error quaternion q 1 etcetera, and then this linear feedback control law you will have to change slightly. You says that this will be equal to minus k q minus c omega. Now, a rigid spacecraft, this actually could be a nonlinear system if you have slightly larger angles. Okay. So, it has been proved that the closed loop nonlinear system of a rigid spacecraft can be made globally asymptotically stable if you choose, you know, these k's and c's that I showed, these k's and c's here and here. If you choose those k's and c's in one of these following manner, it can be proved that you can have asymptotically stable motion and they will all go, the errors will go to 0. So, some of the ways the gains are chosen are this. So, you have this k just a diagonal matrix, you know, you can have this small k and this u is a unit matrix. Usually unit matrix is written as I, but I will be confused with inertia matrix. So, I have written it as unit matrix. So, if k is equal to k u and then you have this C matrix in the gains, you know, this in this gains, if you have the C matrix diagonal C 1, C 2, C 3, then you will have asymptotically stable control system. And also it has been proved that if the capital K is little k divided by this cube of this quaternion q 4, fourth quaternion, and then C is a diagonal matrix, this is also asymptotically stable. And people have also proved that if k is little k times not u, but sine of q 4 u c equal to this c 1 c 2 c 3, this is also asymptotically stable. And also what has been shown that if this k matrix is chosen in this form, alpha I plus beta u, where I is the inertial matrix, inertia matrix, and u is a unit matrix. Of course, alpha and b will have different units because, you know, this here this is kilogram meter square. So, if k is of this inverse and then c is chosen in such a manner that k inverse c is positive definite, in that case also would have asymptotically stable control motion. So, all these, you know, people have proved, and you can find them in, you know, some attitude control or attitude dynamics and control textbooks. So, here I is the inertia matrix and u is the unit matrix or identity matrix 1 1 1 and 0 0. Okay. So, I actually had planned to cover only this much material today and then work out some problems. Okay. I have a couple of problems that I want to work out. So, if you do not mind, we can have a break now and then we will work out some problems. And this momentum wheels we are going to cover tomorrow, this and then fluid loop. The last day we will cover the Coulombic actuators. Okay. So, let us have a break.